Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents We Were Yahoo, From Internet Pioneer to the Trillion-Dollar Loss of Google and Facebook, by Jeremy Ring, narrated by Marguerite Gavin. Prologue. As the hours went by, I used the time to reflect on my adult life. I didn't intend to, but the thoughts that flooded my mind overwhelmed me. I initially thought about how my promising and successful life just a few years earlier turned into such a hellish soap opera. How did I fall so far that I was sitting in a cheap diner, overdosing on vanilla milkshakes with 60-year-old, barely dressed waitresses, waiting for a madman with no teeth and horrible breath to appear for his $4 million that I supposedly owed the mafia because of a bad stock tip? I wondered if any other young, successful internet millionaire faced similar plots. I was out of Yahoo for only 2 years, but it felt like a lifetime. At that moment, I was acutely aware of how depressed I had been for the past 2 years. I hated my life in Florida, I hated my job, and I just wanted life to be normal. But it couldn't be. It is not normal to be a part of growing one of the most iconic companies in the world. It's not normal to have made millions of dollars in my 20s. It's not normal to be 32 years old and have nowhere to go but down. But mostly, it's not normal to be extorted for millions of dollars by someone who introduced himself as the producer of the legendary Broadway show Cats and as the producer of Dustin Hoffman's and Al Pacino's next movie. This crazed lunatic mafia impersonator threatened to kill my family and me, and stalked and tracked us to our 5-star hotel hideout with mercenary bodyguards to warn me that he poisoned my sushi. Sitting alone in a cheap diner as I waited for him to pick up $4 million was not normal life. It was severely effed up. Maybe it was all the milkshakes, but suddenly my mood changed. I no longer felt terrified. I realized I hadn't had this much excitement in 2 years. I vowed to overcome my depression and decided to create a plan for the rest of my life. Waiting for Jerry to appear was an ideal moment to determine my future. I drew a box with 4 squares. The top right square was to ensure I dedicated myself to spirituality. I'd had an epiphany. I had been given so much, but I never gave back. While employed at Yahoo, I treated my years there as a blessing. After resigning and enduring depression and difficulties, I viewed Yahoo as a curse. In truth, it was neither a curse nor a blessing. It was a test. I'd been provided all the resources, but did I have the strength, mind, and wherewithal to dedicate myself to creating a path to improve the lives of others? Up until that point, I hadn't. The second square was an extension of the first. I decided to form my own charity. I wasn't going to continue writing checks to large organizations where money is spent proportionally high on administration costs. I committed that any dollar spent went directly into the community of need. Whatever charitable organization I created had to have my vision where need was most pronounced. I hadn't yet determined what the charity would support, but I decided I had to do something. The third square represented dedication to my children. Both my sons were young, and while I loved them unconditionally, my career had held me back from being as active in their lives as I should have been. I was determined to give my children the proper life lessons and experiences, and ultimately raise them to be productive and compassionate adults. The fourth and final square was a reminder of the Yahoo legacy. It was the for-profit capitalism square. As much as earning money was a curse, it was also an addiction. I wanted to build a business, not just any business, but another world-changing business. Yahoo had created a high bar, and I wanted to exceed it. I wanted to create something that would change the world and allow me to get even wealthier while doing it. I'd just created my 4 pillars of life: spirituality, charity, children, and capitalism. I was reborn. I felt alive and exhilarated. Jerry Davis had done me a favor. Introduction. January 10th, 2000. Several executives just beneath the most senior management were having our regular lunch at Bluefin Sushi. We called ourselves the Internet Crossfire Group. Our debates were legendary. No one let anyone finish their thoughts. The vilest curse words were integrated artfully into every sentence. Most arguments were about the state of Internet companies. eBay, Excite, Lycos, Amazon, E-Trade, E-Toys, E-This, E-That, E-I can't effing believe how much effing money they just raised. Out-of-control valuations of companies that had just gone public, and private companies with no business model, no prospect for revenue, but flush with millions of dollars to spend to build their brand so they too could cash out. This day was particularly animated. We had all awoken to world-shattering news. For $160 billion, America Online had announced it had just acquired Time Warner. The most prestigious media company would now have the three letters AOL before its name. A 10-year-old company, whose only business was inside a computer, was taking over a company whose holdings included a vast magazine empire, the second largest cable network in America, multiple movie studios, professional sports franchises, and as valuable a collection of television and feature film content as anywhere on Earth. Most of the talking heads, and the nation for that matter, were in disbelief and viewed this event as a seismic shift in all things rational. The Internet had not just arrived, it had stomped and crushed traditional business overnight. To us, it was as if corporate America, as we had known it for over a century, was overtaken by liberators, and the leaders of traditional business were walking through town with their hands above their heads on their way to a firing squad. On the other side of the barrel of the rifle were the young, inexperienced, arrogant, paper millionaires taking their turn to rule the new world. For those of us at lunch, that day was a seminal event. We didn't view the AOL takeover as irrational or, for that matter, unexpected. It was possibly sooner than we had anticipated, but an inevitable outcome nevertheless. Our debate that day was one that only we in the entire world could be realistically having at that moment. Should we acquire Disney or Viacom? NBC or CBS? MasterCard or Visa? Our company was 5 years old. All of us at that table were in our mid-20s to early 30s. We were all multimillionaires. We were worth more than Ford, Chrysler, and GM combined. Hell, we were worth more than Disney, Viacom, and News Corp combined. Each of those great American brands could have been swallowed up by us. We were Yahoo! Chapter 1. Starting at the Bottom. The Ring family was raised in Canton, Massachusetts, a middle-class community. None of the residents were wealthy, and no one was particularly impoverished. My family included four children, three brothers and a sister, the youngest child in our family. Our parents had a wonderful, loving marriage. I never even witnessed an argument. We grew up in a small town just south of Boston, the kind of town known for its strong New England work ethic. There was one main road, no McDonald's restaurant, three elementary schools, a middle school, and a 1988 high school graduating class of 250 of the most homogeneous student population imaginable. The town, Canton, was the historic home of Paul Revere. Henry David Thoreau briefly taught at the local high school, where pre-Revolutionary War homes and American flags line the main street. My mother left her job as an elementary school teacher to raise her children, all four of whom were 6 years apart in age. My father sold raincoats and umbrellas. He commuted on the Amtrak train Tuesday through Thursday each week to New York to sell his products in the garment district. His office was in the Empire State Building, which always gave us a source of pride. His goods appeared in old-line department stores such as Woolworth's, Sears, and Kmart. As kids, our fun was to hide high on a hill, above the main road, behind thick brush and bushes. As cars drove by at night, we would throw acorns at their windshields. The brave drivers would stop their cars, hear us roaring with laughter, and inevitably start chasing us. We would scatter, jump fences, climb roofs of commercial buildings, and hide in the woods, knowing we would never be captured or identified. This was our Saturday night amusement. As we got older, we would stand outside packaged liquor stores on Friday nights, begging for someone to buy us beer. The type of guy who always agreed to buy beer for us is the kind who hangs out at 3 a.m. in a quickie mart playing Keno. We always knew that as soon as we saw the special loser, we had our alcohol. We'd give him $20 and tell him to buy us a case of beer, usually something very cheap like Genesio or Schaefer. If we had a little extra, we would splurge for Coors or Budweiser. Once we had our case, we would head for the bleachers, where the rest of the high school students would have already set the bonfire and started their downward spiral from buzzed to drunk to passed out face first. Usually around midnight, the police would shine their lights and get on their bullhorns. We would all run and jump a fence and be off. We knew the cops in our town were all fat and completely out of shape, and there was no way at all that they could keep up with us. Unfortunately, the beer would all be left behind, so the officers would gather up the full cans, put them in their car trunks, and then they would spend the rest of their weekends buzzed, drunk, and passed out face first. Of course, many of these officers were the fathers of our friends, so we would wait until they fell asleep and just steal the beer back. We had a very circular and small world. One night when I was working as a short-order cook, a group of friends stopped by at the end of my shift, just before the restaurant closed. In the next town over, there was an old, decrepit home. It was right out of your worst nightmare. The trees in the front lawn that hadn't been tended in years, the branches hung so low that a good gust of wind would knock them off. Cobwebs hung from the leaves that seemingly hadn't been green in years. Hedges that were unpruned grew into the house. Its garage door looked as if a car had crashed through it. The outside had that dark goop that gets all over white aluminum siding hanging down the house. The gutters were hanging half off. This was the sort of home where you never rang the doorbell on Halloween, because no decorations were needed to make it frightening. The big rumor in town was that this house was owned and occupied by a cult of devil worshippers. There was no way we were going to allow devil worshippers to worship in our community. So a plan was hatched. We were going to drive to the house, get out of the car, and light bottle rockets and firecrackers right by their dilapidated windows. My job was easy. I was the driver. I was chosen as the driver probably because we used my car. It was a 10-year-old Chevy Nova station wagon. This car was a true classic. It had a huge bus-like stick shift in the middle. In the winter, I could never drive alone. Because it was rear-wheel drive only, it could not go up an icy hill. Someone always had to be there to help push the car up the hill. The fan belt constantly broke, and the muffler was usually falling off and scraping against the road. We figured the best way to fix that was just to blast the stereo so we wouldn't have to hear the awful sound of muffler against the street. For someone like myself, having a car like this required learning at least the basics, or risk getting stuck in a massive snowstorm with howling winds and below-zero temperatures. The reason I was chosen to drive, however, was clear. All of us could fit in my Chevy Nova. The plan was simple. Light the fireworks, drive off, laugh hysterically, end up at the package store, find someone to purchase a case of beer for us, meet at the field, and crawl home when the sun rose. It sounded like a perfect night for a 16-year-old. Unfortunately, the plan was quickly derailed. It started smoothly. Everyone jumped into the Chevy Nova, four in front, four in back, and two in the way back. We successfully lit the fireworks. The laughter began. We hopped in the car, pulled out, and drove off to the package store to find the drunk. Unfortunately, just as we pulled onto Bay Road, the sirens blasted and we were busted. The officers demanded we get out of the Chevy. I was terrified. Although I had definitely deserved many times to have been caught, more times than I can count, our actions led to a notice in the police log in the weekly newspaper. Never before had I actually been caught. I didn't know how to react. Fortunately, since it was a small town, they had no interest in charging us with any crime. They were, however, interested in scaring the excretion out of us, which they did quite effectively. The police hauled all of our asses to the station and threw us all in a clink for the night. They called our parents, with whom they were all friends. The cops and our parents hatched a plan that no one would be picked up until the morning, so we all had to spend the night in jail. I can't say that everyone in the group was scared, but I was petrified. I made a promise that night that I've kept the rest of my life since. I will never again drive 10 jerk-offs in a Chevy Nova station wagon to a house that is rumored to be occupied by devil worshippers. It's clear that's a long way from package stores. 10 miscreants crammed in a station wagon, illegal fireworks, and jumping fences to Let's Buy Disney. But that's where my life took me, and I clearly wasn't prepared. I didn't graduate from an Ivy League school. I had no business experience. I was hired at age 25 to be the first Yahoo salesperson, and I hadn't as much sold a cup of lemonade from a lemonade stand. I had never sold before. We opened the entire East Coast operation out of my apartment in Hoboken, New Jersey. I was 25, and I had already held at least 6 jobs, several from which I had been fired, either for being lazy or stupid. I graduated from Syracuse University in 1992 with a degree in advertising. I have no clue why I chose advertising as my major. I hated commercials, and always channel surfed away from them as soon as they appeared. There were other majors I could have pursued. Syracuse was world-renowned for its broadcast media department, with graduates such as Ted Koppel, Bob Costas, Sean McDonough, and dozens of other recognizable names. I could have studied journalism. Today I constantly recognize classmates with bylines in the most prestigious print publications in the country. With the crossover of print journalists to television, I could have been a great sports writer making millions of dollars a year, giving my useless opinion on ESPN, or a political journalist blabbering nonsensical comments on Fox News or MSNBC. Of course, many have said I have a face for radio. Not me, however. For no apparent reason, I chose advertising. After graduation, I moved back home with my parents. I spent the next several months frantically searching for a job. Other than some temporary placements, nothing broke until November, when I received a call from Ogilvy and Mather Advertising in New York. O&M was among the most prestigious advertising agencies in the world. Founded in the 1940s by David Ogilvy, the firm had amassed a client roster greater than any firm on Madison Avenue. Their clients included American Express, Ford, IBM, AT&T, Procter & Gamble, and dozens of other top global brands. They had hundreds of offices all over the world. I had blindly sent them my resume months earlier and was shocked and amazed when they called. The human resources manager who called asked if I could be in New York the next day for an interview. Coincidentally, my father had a meeting in New York scheduled for the following day, so I was able to get to the interview. After interviewing with several executives, they offered me the job. It was my first official job as a college graduate, my first job in the real world. I recall all the speeches during graduation from Syracuse when the speakers told the graduates, "It's cold and harsh in the world. Stay home with your parents." Not me. All I wanted was to leave home. I was tired of sleeping on a twin mattress with a creaky wood platform beneath it, with my late 1980s NFL cheerleader posters on my wall, and bowling trophies from when I was 12 still on the shelves. This was my chance. I was going to live in New York. I was going to live on my own. I was going to get in trouble. Be as stupid as I had imagined stupid was. Learn to smoke cigarettes, which thankfully I hated. Drink real beer like Molson, not Coors. Meet girls who would be impressed that I worked at the largest, most prestigious advertising agency in the world. Meet others in their early 20s and begin lifetime friendships. Go to wild parties that didn't begin until 1 a.m. I had it all planned out, until I didn't. There was one fairly significant problem: the starting salary. It was a measly $19,000 a year. How was I going to live on $19,000 a year in New York? Miller beer was out. Girls were out. Explaining that my starting salary was $19,000 a year was not exactly a good pickup line. I didn't even know how I was going to afford to take the subway to work each day. Knowing the challenges of surviving, I still knew that I had to forge ahead. The first order of business was finding somewhere to live. Analyzing my finances, I determined I could afford $300 per month in rent. I opened up the Village Voice, which in 1992, pre-internet days, was the place to search for New York apartment listings. I quickly realized there wasn't much of a market at my price point. After a few days of researching, I was amazed that one was listed for $300. I jumped all over it, called the landlord, and told him I was on my way over. The apartment was in Park Slope, Brooklyn. While I had always imagined living in Manhattan, Park Slope was a beautiful, well-kept neighborhood, so I wasn't too distraught that I'd be living in Brooklyn. When I arrived, I was thrilled to see a gorgeous apartment overlooking Prospect Park, one of the great treasures of New York. How lucky was I! As I toured the apartment and its three bedrooms, I took note that all the rooms had someone living there, with no one seemingly looking as if they were moving out. I turned to the landlord and asked him what room I would be renting. Hoping he would point to one of the gorgeous rooms off of the hallway, I had to catch myself when he pointed to where I'd be staying. The living room had a small cul-de-sac, just large enough to fit a single twin mattress. My jaw dropped. I asked him, "So you are renting me the closet?" His response was what I should have anticipated. "For $300," he said, "what did you expect?" I had been up, down, and through the Village Voice. I knew there was no other apartment I could afford. My parents were not going to continue to pay for my New York City hotel. I was really left with no choice. Pondering it deeply in my mind, I finally relented and agreed to go live in the closet. The next week, I officially started my new job at O&M. Even though my salary was minimum wage, I was still excited that I would be working in a professional environment for one of the most successful advertising firms of all time. I was truly looking forward to learning the business and was dreaming of a long and successful career in advertising. About a half dozen of us started that first day. We all began as assistant media planners, responsible for providing support to the media planners whose role was to determine the times and programs the television and radio spots would run, in which magazines the print ads would appear, in what cities to purchase billboards, and anything else that had to do with the planning of an ad campaign. Although I dreamed of being in the creative department, I had neither creativity nor artistic ability, so my only fallback was the media team. That morning we went through the typical first-day activities, such as hearing about insurance and benefits, signing for the company handbook, learning where the bathrooms were, being assigned to a cubicle, and last, discovering which account we would be working on. Most of the new hires were assigned either to the IBM or American Express account, which just happened to be the two most prestigious accounts in the firm. When it came time for my assignment, I was told to report to the Pepperidge Farm team. I felt as if I were picked last on the playground. My new colleagues on IBM and American Express were the popular kids in class. The girls were gorgeous and the guys were preppy and funny. I was none of that. I was short, skinny, and had the personality of an empty beer bottle. My fears were realized that first day when our vendors splurged for Knicks tickets and dinner both for the IBM and American Express teams. At the end of the first day, I left the building alone. It was dark, cold, and snowing, and all I had to look forward to was returning to my closet. As the weeks passed, it became more apparent that I had been screwed by being assigned to the Pepperidge Farm account. O&M was a company with hundreds of offices across the world, with more than 14,000 employees. It was the most prestigious firm with the most prestigious clients, and I felt as if I were the least relevant employee worldwide. My suspicions were not without some validation. I was at the lowest salary scale in the company. I had the dullest account in the company. I was about 10,000 layers down from the CEO, who would never have a clue who I was, and my direct boss was only making $24,000 a year. I worked at O&M from November 1992 through March 1994. During that time, all the people with whom I'd started were promoted to media planner. I was stuck as an assistant media planner. The job was awful. No one but me knew how to use a computer. For those 14 months, my only task was to take the handwritten charts handed to me and make them presentable using either PowerPoint or Excel. I was doing administrative work, and the problem I had was that the secretaries were all paid $30,000 a year. O&M had this great bargain with me. Make me the secretary, but pay me like a third-world farm worker. I learned absolutely nothing about the media business. Never once did I meet with magazine publishers or network executives. I had no clue when and on what programs our spots were scheduled to air, and above all, I didn't care that Pepperidge Farm remembers. It was obvious that I wasn't going to be promoted to media planner anytime soon. My time as an underpaid secretary prevented me from learning the skills I needed to be a full-fledged media planner. I would go home each night and pull hair out of my head because I hated my job so much. It wasn't challenging. No one gave a damn about me, and at a level where we were all entry-level and no one had any experience. I was the least experienced assistant media planner in the entire industry. Something had to give. I either had to quit and find another job, or I had to be promoted, which even in my young, inexperienced mind, I knew would likely be impossible. I figured I'd try the Hail Mary pass and ask for a promotion. I made an appointment with the media director, who was the boss of the entire media department. He was an older gentleman who was aloof, but at least he knew who I was, which can't be said for the other 99% of the department. He was one of those executives who was afraid of a computer, so he often dropped his chicken scratch on my desk and asked me to turn it into something presentable. I walked into his office, not intimidated at all. I figured the worst that would happen was he would fire me. I knew there were other jobs, such as being a trash collector, berry picker, doorman, museum security, or even rodeo clown, that would pay at least $21,000 a year. I figured some of those jobs would likely be available. I promptly got right to the purpose of my visit. I demanded to know if and when I was going to get a promotion. I most assuredly startled him. You could see the wheels turning. He was struggling with how to answer me. I didn't need him to say much. His body language said it all. He was finally able to cobble together something barely coherent, but the message was clear. I was not ready for a promotion. I hadn't done enough to learn the intricacies of being a media planner. I thought to myself, no shit. I had no real exposure to the business nor to a mentor who was guiding me. Another clear point was that he didn't want to fire me. Why would he? I was the cheapest secretary they had, and my understanding of Microsoft Excel and PowerPoint made me more than a commodity to him. Even though I shouldn't have been surprised, I was still livid. I even requested a transfer to the IBM or American Express teams. I was quickly rebuffed with the "there is no room" line. No room? Are you effing kidding me? Each of these two clients was spending hundreds of millions of dollars a year, and they didn't have room for a $19,000 a year glorified secretary? No, this was clearly a case of the jocks not wanting to have to mingle with the unpopular kids. I thought that ended after middle school. I never imagined it existed in corporate America. I wasn't going to take this. I was going to do what any self-respecting, just dumped-upon, total loser would do. I was going to go out to find a job that paid $22,000 a year. Fortunately for me, it did not take very long. It's stunning how many companies will hire young kids who are eager to learn while being used and demand almost nothing in return. I even received an unanticipated bonus. The name of the firm was Publicis Blum, and this position paid $23,000 a year. Unlike Ogilvy and Mather, this was a very small agency. They had only two floors of a building in Midtown. They were a small satellite office of a much larger French advertising conglomerate. I was under the radar, away from the massive Madison Avenue monstrosities. They had a nice but not overwhelming client list. They represented the Bacardi brands, some traditional packaged goods accounts, and several business-to-business clients who spent significantly in trade publications. Just before my arrival, they had brought on a new client, the CIT Group, and I was assigned to work on this new account. CIT was a Fortune 500 company that had been founded in the early 1900s to provide loans for small business and middle-market lending. The company had billions of dollars in revenue. However, it was actually a last resort loan company. The interest payments were inordinately high. They were my client, and they were a major corporation, but I viewed them as one step above a New York check-cashing store and two steps above getting a loan from Tony Soprano. There is little to report on this very quick and minor stop through the underworld of the New York advertising mafia, other than to say I was fired after 6 months simply for sucking at my job. As I discovered, the only responsibility for this account was to buy print ads every day in newspapers nationwide. It wasn't as if we were buying full-page, four-color spreads in USA Today. We were buying quarter-page ads in local newspapers in cities like Peoria, Racine, Cheyenne, Mobile, Elmira, Allentown, East, Do You Really Exist? West, Are You Effing Kidding Me? North, So You Married Your Sister? And South, Your Wooden Teeth Are Rotting. I couldn't handle it. I should have snapped, but instead, I just retreated. I'd show up every morning at 10 o'clock. At noon, I would disappear for a 2-hour lunch. I'd reappear at 2 o'clock and play Minesweeper and Solitaire on the computer until 5 o'clock, when I'd run out the door faster than Carl Lewis in the 100-meter dash. I never took the time to make my cubicle even look as if someone worked there. There were no papers on the desk, no pictures on the walls, just a big-ass print on the chair from hours of mindless solitaire on the PC. Now, to be clear, I wholeheartedly deserved this firing. I would have fired me. A 6-year-old would have fired me. The guy who came by the office once a week to shine our shoes would have fired me. The old man in the food truck would have fired me. When the head of the media department called me into her office, I half-heartedly wanted to ask her, "What took you so long?" If it had been me, I would have just pointed toward the door, told me to get out, and been done with me. I did no work. I had no belongings. There would never even need to be a record that I had ever worked there. To my great luck, I wasn't the one firing me. I was fired by someone who had a heart. The head of media was a woman who had obviously been in the business forever. She was from the old days of Mad Men. She looked as if she partook in the fun about 1,000 times too many. I'm sure her memory of the 70s was a fog, but considering her history, she made me the kindest and fairest offer I'd ever received. I was fired in late September, and the company agreed to pay me through the end of the year. Because my salary was so pathetic, I hadn't saved as much as the cost of a subway token. With this unexpected gift, I had time to launch a real job search and not be forced to take a job as a bike messenger or museum guard. They were paying me to leave. I always knew what severance was, but I'd never heard of it being offered to a $23,000-a-year low-level employee whose biggest claim to fame was owning the Minesweeper record on the company computer. By the next day, I had launched my job search. Although I wasn't going to settle for some dead-end glorified secretary role, I was nevertheless anxious. I was hopeful that, if I found an opportunity quickly, I'd have two salaries for the remainder of the year. I did, in fact, go on several interviews, many of which either turned me down outright or it was clear that the position simply sucked. My first interview was with Young and Rubicam, or Y&R. Y&R was a clone to Ogilvy and Mather. It had hundreds of offices, thousands of employees, and the most prestigious clients. The men wore suits and carried briefcases. It was row after row of cubicles. Walking through the quiet hallways, you could hear a fly fart. My impression was that the rank-and-file staff needed a note from management for permission to speak. I had flashbacks of O and M. The hair on my back was standing, the hair on my arms was crawling, the hair on my head was regressing. My lunch was two-thirds up my throat. In my mind, I was calculating what would be worse, selling tokens in a New York City subway token booth or working as a media planner at Y&R. Fortunately for me, I wasn't given a chance to work at Y&R. After interviewing with several executives, I was told a few days later that I wasn't right for the position, which was a decision that would come back to haunt them later. I had several more interviews. It seemed as if I were walking in a dark forest, where all the trees had come to life and the branches reached out in hopes of grabbing and crushing me. Nothing was working. I even tried to interview with a brokerage firm that offered me a position. Now, the fact that the job paid nothing, I'd have to make 400 cold calls per day, and I'd have to pay for the industry exams myself, was just a tad more of a tipping point than the free coffee and copy of the Wall Street Journal they offered each day. Just as I was losing all hope, my luck changed. A job placement recruiter, who took pity on me, called me to tell me about an advertising agency in Greenwich Village. The firm, she promised me, was young, exciting, and dynamic. She set up an interview for me that afternoon. I went back to my apartment, put on a suit I had purchased at Men's Warehouse just so I could look my best during the interview process, caught the F train downtown, and was at the offices of MVBMS within the hour. The second I got off the elevator felt like a magical moment. I stepped off and froze. I had to stare at my surroundings. The agency was two floors of a loft. In the middle was the coolest spiral staircase I've ever seen. Its stairs were glass, but as you stepped on each stair, a gray film appeared, turning the stair translucent. The main conference room had a towering mural of a three-ring circus. The walls of the office were all brick, giving a true downtown loft feel for the office space. There was a pinball machine as well as a foosball table. Most of all, everyone, men and women, wore jeans and t-shirts. The whole environment was breathtaking to me, and after a short wait, I was led back to the interview. I interviewed with a stunning 6-foot-tall, thin woman. She was gorgeous in a very natural way, no makeup, straight long hair, not pretentious, and very happy about her job. We spoke for about an hour, and we instantly hit it off. The account I would be assigned to was MCI, which was a very hot long-distance company that had gained tremendous market share and was seen as a very credible threat to AT&T. The fact that, eventually, they would break every law in existence and much of their management team would end up in federal prison was of no consequence to me in 1994. At this point, the staff was considered young, brash, and aggressive. Most important, MCI was one of the first real companies to embrace the Internet, which forever changed our society and how we conduct business as a platform. By the time I left the building, I knew not only had I hit it out of the park during the interview, but I had to have that job. When I received the offer of the position a few days later, a feeling of jubilation overcame me. For the first time in my professional career, a ball bounced my way. I was only 24, but I had a strong sense that this was the break I needed. The job offered to me was media planner, with a salary of $28,000 a year. Considering 2 years earlier I had been making $19,000 a year, I was satisfied that at least I was moving forward financially. After moving out of the closet in Park Slope, for the past year I had been living with my brother on 9th Avenue, in the neighborhood called Hell's Kitchen. My bedroom was the living room and my bed was the couch. Although I had no illusions that I wasn't still poor, I had at least graduated from being dirt poor and virtually homeless. With my new raise, Plus the severance money I was still being paid from my previous job, I was able to afford a real bedroom in an apartment in Hoboken, New Jersey. Hoboken was a great town for young people in their 20s who were just starting out in life and couldn't afford to live in Manhattan. The only downside was riding the urine-stenched red crapple apple bus to and from the Port Authority bus station each day. I couldn't contain my excitement on my first day at work. I had hidden my men's warehouse suit in the back of my closet, figuring I would never need to wear a suit again, and put on a pair of Gap jeans and a Boston Red Sox t-shirt. I was ready for my first day. I was even assigned a real office, not a cubicle. The office was small and nondescript, but I'd never had a door at work before. Come to think of it, I didn't even have a door in any of the places I lived in New York. Little did society realize just how transformational these days were. Just a little over a year earlier, a 20-year-old entrepreneur named Mark Andreessen had left the University of Illinois to develop a company and a product called Netscape. Netscape was the first consumer-centric web browser. It was the first window into the world that would change the course of life for almost everyone on this planet. Initially, few established businesses took advantage of this vast opportunity. Online services such as AOL, Prodigy, and CompuServe were trusted platforms, but they were closed environments that provided basic news, finance, sports, and entertainment information. The fact that many AOL users visited their service for the purpose of participating in adult porn chats was never discovered by the old line companies. An open environment such as the World Wide Web? Stay away from that. It's just porn, bomb-making kits, and message boards filled with George Carlin's 7 words you can never say on television. Or at least that's how I imagined firms such as O&M and Y&R were describing the internet to their clients. In their backward, stale, 19th-century minds, of course they would steer their clients away from a new medium. They drew storyboards using genuine artists. Technologically speaking, their creative teams were as sharp as a marble. No one within their organizations possessed the capabilities to develop websites. MVBMS was different, and we had the perfect client to embrace this new dynamic world. For us, this was the game changer, and we were going to be the leaders. Both MVBMS and MCI would establish me as a 21st-century thinker and technological leader. While traditional businesses weren't embracing the online world, a cottage industry was being developed by early leaders in the space. Wired, which launched around this time, was the first publication to feature a digital as well as print version of their magazine. The title was Hotwired, and very intelligently they offered businesses a space to advertise at the top of the homepage. These early advertisements were conceived as digital billboards. They were static, meaning they remained on the same page at all times and did not link to any specific website. Of course, few businesses yet had created websites to which the billboards could link. The first advertisers on Hotwired were MCI, Toyota, and Pepsi. Although it's been disputed who was actually first, there is no disputing that MCI was among the first businesses to embrace online advertising. Each day, I'd arrive at work early, awake, and ready to tackle another opportunity. I'd never had this sense of euphoria at work before. My mind was racing. I was on the ground floor of an entirely new advertising medium, one that I clearly sensed would not only reshape the media business, but one that would forever alter how we communicate, find information, and purchase products. I pictured myself as one of a small group of individuals who was invited to a party introducing the most important new product in the history of the world. The power of the internet took over my very being. I even had a jolting sense that this window into a new world would shape the rest of my life. It was 1995, and a year earlier, my father had passed away. Had he returned to Earth after even a single year, he wouldn't have recognized the planet. Netscape launched, Yahoo launched, and other search engines were springing up. Email was replacing voicemail as the entire internet began inching itself into mainstream society. In the summer of 1995, The MVBMS team had a brilliant idea, though honestly it wasn't a huge stretch. The Hotwired experiment demonstrated that ads could be delivered to individuals online. Hotwired was simply a print magazine that happened to be on the internet, and its ads were just static billboards. For the internet to demonstrate that it was a new medium, certain criteria would have to be met. To justify its value, we had to ensure that as a user clicked on the banner, it would transport them directly to the MCI website, and then implement an action, most likely a transaction. It was the cleanest and most efficient means to validate an advertiser's campaign.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.